Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to read this from the NIV, New International Version. And then I'm going to highlight some of these verses from the message. Amen. Beginning in verse 15 of chapter 50 in the NIV. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did to him?" So they sent word to Joseph saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father." When that message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. "We are your slaves," they said. But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid, I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Joseph stayed in Egypt along with all of his father's family. He lived 110 years and saw the third generation of Ephraim's children, also the children of Machir, son of Manasseh, were placed at birth with Joseph's knees. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "I'm about to die, but God will surely come to your aid and take you up out of this land to the land he promised and oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." And Joseph made the sons of Israel swear an oath and said, "God will surely come to your aid, and then you must carry my bones up from this place." So Joseph died at the age of 110. And after they embalmed him, he was placed in a coffin in Egypt. Now, let me read from the Messenger in terms of highlighting the statement that the brothers said to Joseph. I'm going to start at verse 18. Then the brothers went in person to him, threw themselves on the ground before him and said, "We are your slaves." Joseph replied, "Don't be afraid. Do I act for God? Don't you see you planned evil against me? But God used those same plans for my good. As you see all around you right now, life for many people. Easy now, you have nothing to fear. I'll take care of you and your children." He reassured them, speaking with them heart to heart. I'll stop right there. So this is the reading of God's word, Jesus. And in this last chapter, this last message, we want to look at a pilgrim faith. A pilgrim faith. A pilgrim faith. Now, what I will attempt to do, especially the time that we have, in all of these chapters in Genesis from 37 to 50, you know, we have chopped them up into segments and we've looked at them progressively as we went along. I want us to look at God's providence over and through all of this. And then I want to end up by looking at a character study of Joseph and the traits that he represented that these traits are part of our lives as believers in Christ. And they are spelled out in the New Testament. these principles are presented here in the Old, and they are practiced in the New. They are outlined in the Old Testament, but when you come to the New Testament, we are told this is how you do it. For example, we see in terms of, in these many chapters from verse 7 to 50, we see first of all, love. Just love. But not man's love, God's love, God's eternal love. When we come over to the New Testament, John elaborates over and over again in his first three letters, and he talks about what? The love of God. He tells us that the reason why we're able to love, because God first loved us, showed us how to love, and realizing that when we love him, then his power in us enables us to love others, right? So every principle in the Old Testament, it is elucidated, it is spelled out, it is practiced in the New Testament. Now, there are several principles here about God in these verses. First of all, we want to look at the providence of God, God's providence. You hear that word over and over again, like the omnipotence of God, the omnipresence of God. These are what theologians call big words. But the question is, what do these big words mean? In actuality, the providence of God means this. God can and will, defeat sin and evil for his divine purpose. That's basically what it boils down to. God can override, he can redirect in terms of whatever he chooses to. Why? Because he has the authority and the power to do it. We see in Psalms, and we also see in Proverbs, where we're told that God brings down kingdoms. He brings kings down that are evil. He replaces kings on the throne that are representing his heart. For an example, and let's give an example in the Old Testament, David and Saul. Amen. David was the one that God chose to be the king of Israel. Is that correct? Saul was really, Saul was not God's choice. He was the choice of the people. And God told Samuel, okay, they want a king. They want to be like other folks. They want to conquer the world. Go ahead. They can have it. And Saul started out to get well, but then after a while, he started falling into depravity, which means he started doing things his way, what he felt like doing. In fact, he became so evil in the end until he went to a witch to find out what direction he should go with the throne. Okay. David had every opportunity to kill Saul. At first, David was Saul's best friend. David would come and play his harp, would soothe this evil spirit in Saul. But then, the satanic forces started telling Saul, David hates you. David don't like you. And David is going to try to undermine you. So Saul started hating David. David had to start running for his life, hiding in caves. And again, as I said, he had several opportunities to take the life of Saul. But David made this statement. He said, in fact, his men that were a part of him, they wanted David to kill Saul. But David said, no, I will not kill God's anointed one. In other words, I'm going to wait and let God put me on the throne. I'm not going to do it my way. And we know that finally Saul and Jonathan, his son, were killed in battle. David was put on the throne. The providence of God. God, we use the terminology, God moves in mysterious ways. That's what providence is. His wonders to perform,
bless his footsteps and to see him rise with every storm. We don't know what God is going to do. And not only on a national, on a global, on a universal scale, but also on a personal scale in my life and your life. Even when we are not aware of it, did you not know that God is working on your behalf? How many of y'all want to raise your hand? We belong to him. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that everything works together for good to them that love the Lord, to them what? That are called according to his purpose. And then he goes on to talk about those that have been called, he's glorified. Those he's glorified, he's sanctified, and blah, blah, blah. When you are in Christ, God has promised that he will take care of his children. In the 10th chapter of John's Gospel, beginning at verse 27, he talks about in terms of those sheep that are part of his fold. And he says that the sheep that are mine, my Father gave them to me because they were his. And everything that daddy, and forgive me if you use this terminology, and I'm not trying to be irrespective or irrelevant, but I'm saying this according to my language. What daddy has given me, no one can what? Snatch them out of my hands. They couldn't take them from him, they can't take them from me. Why? Because he and I are what? One. Okay. And that argues against the fact that when some people believe, and these are Christians, that they can lose their salvation, scripture does not support that. That's a lie. Because if you can lose your salvation, then what does that say about God who has all power? If he calls you, and if he saves you, and sanctifies you, and then he loses you, then that means what? He doesn't have all power. That means he's just like these other gods here in the world, which are worth nothing. Amen? So the providence of God, we see him really all through the whole book of Genesis, but especially in the life of Jacob and in Joseph's life specifically. For if it had not been for God's providence, his plan, his rule, Joseph would have never been in Egypt. But notice how God, in spite of how the brothers felt about him, they hated him, they begrudged him, they resented him, they had malice and hostility against him, and of course, Dad and Jacob had a lot to do with that, but still, remember that they decided we would kill him, and they threw him in a pit, and Jacob at that time was 17 years of age, you remember, and well, naturally, being a teenager, yeah, he had some cockiness. He had some, you know, he was a little bit, you know, on the arrogant side, like a lot of young folk are. You know, he thought that he knew everything. And we could see that implied in the dreams that God gave him and how he interpreted and related those dreams to his brothers and to his father. But still, he didn't deserve what they did to him. And they sold him into slavery. Then when he got down to Egypt, look at the transition in terms of God's providence. He sold to Potiphar. Potiphar is captain of the guards of Pharaoh's army, right? And Potiphar sees his managerial skills. He manages everything well. He sees a good spirit in Joseph. So what does Potiphar do? He puts Joseph in charge over all of his house, all of his slaves, everything, except his wife. And you remember in terms of how she lied on Joseph and claimed that Joseph raped her. Joseph was innocent of that. He was put in jail. And I have a feeling that Potiphar had he knew that Joseph didn't do that. But see, the way that she put it, she somewhat put him in a bind. Put him in a corner. So he had no choice. He had to do it. He was put in prison. He stayed there a long time. And then God worked it out through his right spirit that he was over the baker and the butler. Remember, God gave him dreams. God gave Joseph interpretation of their dreams. When they got out of prison, he said to them, tell Pharaoh, don't forget about me. The butler got out, forgot about Joseph. 2 more years he's in prison, hasn't done anything, he's innocent, shouldn't be there. Does that sound similar to our lives? Have you ever gone through some trouble, some trials that was not a part of your doing, that in terms of what happened, it was something that came about because of what other folk did? Have you ever gone through something like that? Folk lying on you, doing something, not mind you? Have you ever gone through something like that? No difference, no difference. Only he was back there, we're here. But in terms of the working process and what happens in human nature doesn't change. You hear what I'm saying? Human nature, well, let me say it another way. Sin don't change. The costumes change. The background changes. The scenery changes. But the characters change. But the plot always remains the same. But God didn't let Joseph stay in that prison. But he was preparing Joseph for what he had for him later on. Finally, 2 years later, God gives Pharaoh 2 dreams. Well, lo and behold, there's nobody that can interpret those dreams but who? Joseph. So Joseph is brought out of prison. He interprets Pharaoh's dreams. And then Pharaoh makes him prime minister of the whole nation of Israel. Now he comes from rags to riches. He's the bad man now. And no longer nobody's going to do wrong to him. If anything, he's going to start cutting off heads. Now, some people, because of what their relatives and family did to them, they were going to get what? Revenge. Amen? Oh, you know they would. Say amen. You know they were going to get even. Because folk who are dead don't have that much done to them. You know. That's the reason why families are split apart. That's the reason why people on jobs, you are supposed to get a promotion, and they leapfrog somebody over you that's less qualified, because that's who they want. It hurts. This is life. It don't change. Sin don't change. Men are going to continue to do wrong things, bad things, and it ain't just out there in the world, but it's also sometimes in the house of God. Amen. But Joseph didn't allow this to sour or to embitter his spirit. Now, that ain't easy to do, y'all. You know what I'm saying? It ain't easy to keep a spirit of honey in the midst of vinegar, folk. And I use that terminology because I'm sure now everybody knows what honey is, you know what vinegar is. So you can mentally, you can see the difference there. Honey surrounded by vinegar and trying to keep what? Sweetness and love in the midst of people that are nasty, that are small and bitter in their lives. Joseph didn't do it.